If you know, you know.
From your local town to your mobile device, it's time to wake up with Teflon John for the real talk with Teflon in the morning show. Only on Teflon Radio. Download the Teflon Radio app now. Available on Android and iOS.
Hey, what's up, everyone? It's your boy Teflon John, and this is the first episode of Real Talk with Teflon John in the morning. I got my co-host Tammy, and we got special guest Daniel Barksdale. So what's up, man? Like, how are you doing?
Pretty good. Pretty good. All is well.
So by this being the very first episode, we got my co-host Tammy. You got anything that you want to say? Because it's early. We've been up early this morning.
Nah, I don't have a lot to say first thing in the morning, Jonathan.
Am I up yet? I'm joking.
Nah. All right, so Daniel Barksdale, Lynchburg resident.
Yes.
All right, so tell me a little bit about your backstory, right?
So currently I'm 26 years old, and I am a singer and then also a playwriter. So the singing came first, and then the playwriting came second. And I've been singing since I was 5, and then I've been doing plays since I was 16. But born and raised in Lynchburg, Virginia. So been here all my life.
Okay. So yeah. when you say playwright, like, what influenced you to get into plays?
Basically, so my uncle, he used to buy these bootleg Tyler Perry DVDs. Mm-hmm. And I used to always watch them when I was little, mm-hmm. so much that I can, like, I guess, know what they're going to say and say it with them or whatever the case might be. And so I was just always interested in how he did his stuff. So I would write like mock plays back then. And basically I just became, got older and I started writing more plays and they became to get more serious. And then that's kind of how I kind of got into the plays. You did say the plays, right?
Yeah, the plays.
Yeah, the plays. Yeah. So yeah. And then I wrote a Christmas play because my church had asked for one. And yeah, so then from there on, I just kept doing them from that point on. So yeah.
That's kind of crazy.
Yeah. So you say that Tyler Perry, I guess, is your influence. So is that what your goal is? Are you working to get that big and be
whatever.
Tyler Perry in the making?
I don't know. Because, I be seeing all the stuff that he got going on. And I don't think I will want that much on my plate. But if God gives it to me, I will receive it. But my main goal right now is just to bring great entertainment to people with plays. And if it gets bigger than that, I'm okay with it. Mm-hmm. But for right now, I'm happy with, just doing the plays. Because, he got TV shows and movies and stuff like that. And mm-hmm. I don't know if I want to do all that. Because I can barely write 60 pages worth of a play. I don't know how much I could do. 60 pages, yeah. It'd be 60, 65, some of them. But, mm-hmm. I know a movie script is way more than that probably. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, whew, I don't know if I can do that.
So, I'm sorry. Do you base your plays on, certain things, or are you just open to do whatever comes to mind?
So yeah, whatever the Lord gives me, that's what I usually write my plays on. And sometimes, like I said, I can see things and I can be like, okay, that could be something great to write about. You know what I'm saying? If somebody's going through something, uh-huh. I'm like, okay, not to use what they're going through, but I can kind of use that in a way to tell a story about how to get through it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. In a play. Because a lot of people come to my plays, they don't go to church. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But they are able to find something in the play because of the fact that we're either speaking to them or speaking to a situation they've been through or currently going through.
So most of them are Christian-based?
Most of them are, yeah. I would actually say all of them are. But, I mean, it's not like you're going to church. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes people, they get that confused because they think that, he sings gospel. So when they come to a show, they're going to be, in church for 2 hours. But it's really not like that because we turn it up in my shows.
Okay.
Literally.
Okay.
I mean, they be cussing and everything. For real, what I'm saying? Yeah. That's how mm-hmm. life is. You're not saying God is good all the time.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't say that coming in here when somebody tried to cut me off the road.
Yeah.
God forgive me.
I feel you.
You know what I'm saying? You come back to that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, so what do you think, what was a play where you seen and you was like, oh, I can do that? Like, do you remember the name of it?
It was Addicted. So what happened was, is that the Christmas play that I did was Meet the McCarters, but I don't consider that as being my first play. Mm-hmm. My first play was Meet the McCarters, and then the second play was Addicted. Mm-hmm. So that was the one, because I looked out, we were at my church doing the show, and they were in the fellowship hall, and the kitchen was near the fellowship hall, and I was able to look at the blinds, mm-hmm. and I saw the room was full to capacity, and I was like, wow. And in that moment, I was like, this is what I want to do. I'll never forget how I felt when I looked out and saw those that many people was waiting to see the play. Because at first I was like, it's going to probably be like 30 people. Because we set up, I think it was like 80-something, 90-something chairs. But with ticket sales, they were $5 at the time. The cast were giving me, it was like only 30 that we sold. So when I looked out, I'm like, how did all these people come to the show when I, in my head, it's going to be like 30-something? So from that moment, I was like, this is what I really want to do.
Okay. That's what's up.
Yeah.
You ever been to a play, Tammy?
Well,
I've never been to a Daniel Barksdale play. That's the question.
Tyler Perry play, and, you know, I haven't went to yours. So I'm looking forward to getting to one, though. When is the next one? Like, do you have dates?
Or? We do. Our next one and the last one in Lynchburg is June 24th at Destiny Christian Fellowship. And that's this coming Saturday.
Okay. And with that's over by Paramount, right?
Like it is.
Got you. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
It's Bishop Jay and Pastor Kim's church.
Gotcha.
Uh-huh, yep. Uh-huh.
So is that where you always do your plays?
Recently. I started at my church, and then I moved in because of the space. We had outgrew the space in the fellowship hall. So then I took them to the recreational center. Mm-hmm. And then after that, that's when they got moved to Destiny because I found a band. And the band, at the time, they played for Destiny. Uh-huh. And so I was just like, you know, it worked out perfect. They had their equipment there. We can have the show there. So they had to move equipment. And so that's how we got it at Destiny.
Yeah. Okay.
So, and they've been amazing partner to work with the shows because, you know, they trust me and I trust them and it's just a beautiful partnership.
Beautiful partnership.
Beautiful partnership, yes.
You hear that, Tammy? That's what we got to develop, that beautiful partnership.
That's it.
Come on.
So tell me this, what have some of your challenges been in doing this? You said you started at 16. Mm-hmm. That was when you wrote your first one?
Yeah.
Because I know myself, you know, you'll have a plan for yourself. You want to do things a certain way. Mm-hmm. You see them a certain way, but it doesn't always pan out that way.
Right,
so over the years of you doing it, because you say you're 26 now, so that's 10 years ago, if I'm doing my math right.
Yes.
I'm sure it's been some kind of issues along the way.
It has. You know, the one that I can really think of now is just finding people. That's been like the hardest. Well, not now, but it was a hard thing to find people because, you know, God would give me all these characters and I'm like, okay, that's great. And I know the storyline, all this, you know, different things. And then I write the script and it's like, okay, well, who's going to play this part? Who's going to play that part? Because at the time I was looking for like my church members. But I mean, I'm not going to say they wasn't qualified, but I just don't believe those are the people who God wanted to be in the play.
Play.
Gotcha.
And that
was
the hardest part to be able to find people. But like I always say, you know, when you're following God's will, you know, he will provide. And he did that. And it wasn't even me looking for people. They just kind of showed up by association.
Okay.
So, like, basically, like, if I asked you to be a part of the show and you said yes, and then I say, hey, well, do you know somebody else can be this character? And you're like, oh, yeah, I know this person. And then that's kind of how it went.
Okay.
So that would probably be the hardest part. And I guess the second one would have to be getting the seasoned saints on board when we went to different churches presenting the show. Because a lot of people, at first, they didn't agree with the plays being at the altar. And stuff
gotcha.
Like
so could you give us, like, an example of that?
So when we first began, I got to make sure I'm on camera. I can't be saying too much. I don't want to hurt my feelings. No, I'm joking.
Well, let's just not say names.
Right. I'm just going to say person one, person two. No, I'm joking. But so when we first started doing the plays, we would take them to churches. And I was already a little nervous because some of the stuff in it was, you know, like I said, real life content. And me, I don't water down my stuff. It is what it is. So when we were taking
like
them to... Right. You know, we were taking them to the churches. A lot of the seasoned saints, they didn't like it. So some of them would walk out during the show. And they would just be saying, hey, you shouldn't be doing that at the church. And that don't belong in the church. And I'm saying to myself, I mean, you can... Yes, there are certain things that should not be in the church. But this is ministry work. And ministry is not going to always look the same to everybody.
And at the end of the day, it's real life stuff.
And it's real life stuff. And the things we were talking about, you know, they weren't necessarily... I don't think people were really talking about in church. You know what I'm saying? We were talking about a whole lot of different topics. But, I mean, at the end of the day, these are people... People are going through these things Monday through Saturday. You know what I'm saying? And people just, they never understood that when I was presenting them at first. They were just making it seem like, oh, well, you know, what he's doing really shouldn't be in church because of, you know, we should keep it, I guess, holy or whatever. Just sing songs, preach, and go home. But I was saying to myself, it's way more that we can do to bring people in, you know? So that was a challenge, too, in the beginning. And that's why I cut off doing them at churches.
So let's segue for a little bit because I want to talk about that. You know what I mean? Like, because when you think about Jesus and how he preached, he used parables, stories. So why do you think it's hard for people, like, they get locked into this the traditional form of ministry versus, like what we're doing, radio show?
Yeah.
Or using social media or using movies?
Yeah. honestly, I just think just how people have been brought up. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes it's kind of hard to break those thought patterns, I think. You know what I'm saying? And I respect everybody's. I really do. I respect. I mean, if you feel like that, I respect your, you know, feelings. But I also think that in return, you should respect my feelings.
Yeah.
How I just don't agree with that.
What do you think, Tammy?
I think a lot of times people are set in their ways. A lot of people are in denial. They don't want to see or hear or see other people talk about real life stuff. You know, honestly speaking myself, some things make me uncomfortable when I talk about it. But at the end of the day, if it's a discussion that needs to be had, I'm going to have it. And so for me, I think, I mean, I say go for it. I think if God puts something on your heart to do, you should do it.
Just
you can't
do it.
Water it down for other people.
You can't.
And me, I'm a very upfront person. I'm a very blunt person.
Right.
And a lot of times people can't handle that.
Right.
But what I'm learning is I can't change who I am and what I'm trying to do in life. And that's how it should be with you, with your place. So I'm glad you didn't give up on it, because had you given up based on the people who were supportive and who weren't supportive.
Right.
You wouldn't be here today on the first day of Teflon in the morning.
I'm so thankful. Early in the morning.
Early in the morning. But it's crazy, I think, being a creator, right, being creative. And I'm pretty sure you have those ideas. Like, if I'm making a beat or even thinking about this, is you'll have those struggles where somebody will come up against it.
Yeah.
No matter what it is, right? And then you feel kind of connected to it, because this is your child. Like, this is your baby, because you're really giving birth to it.
Right.
So what is your advice for someone out there that's not going forward because of someone?
I would just say I wouldn't put too much energy and worry about those who don't get it. You know what I'm saying? I would just think you need to, first of all, worry about those who do get it, because the people who do get it will take you further than those who don't get it. And I feel like everybody's not going to agree on everything we do anyway.
That's
Somebody's
right.
not going to agree with the conversation we're having right now.
You
know what I'm saying? So it's kind of like, I mean, am I going to spend my time worried about those who don't get it or those who do get it? And I mean, I'm going to keep it spiritual as possible. I pray for you. You know what I'm saying? But in the day, I'm not going to stress out the fact that you don't understand my thought process. And then furthermore, God didn't give it to you anyway. He gave it to me.
He gave it to you.
Exactly. You know, and maybe what I'm doing isn't for you in the first place. Go find what is.
That's right.
And leave my business alone.
All right.
Respectfully.
We don't get along real good.
Respectfully.
Leave my business alone.
So tell me this. You know, of course, us Black people, business, dreams, goals, we always have in our minds of who was going to support us.
Yes.
And who's not going to support us.
Yes.
What have you learned about your support system?
I have a great support system. I really do. And, you know, I mean, the people in Lynchburg and people that I don't even know, like, they be coming up to me and they've been to a show. And I feel bad because I'm like, dang, I don't really know you. You know, I mean, you know, but they really come up and they say how much they're, you know, proud and they support and X, Y, and Z. And I treat everybody like I know them anyway. You know, even if you came to a show and we really didn't kind of, you know, connect like that because you kind of left maybe before I can even get a, you know, chance to shake your hand. I'm still embracing and hugging and not acting like, you know, some people, you know, so.
Take it personal.
Yeah, you know, so, I mean, the support system is just awesome here. I'm really grateful to
everybody.
So
do you find that people who don't know you support you more than people who do?
Of course, yes. It's always the ones who don't know you. You know what I'm saying? Like the ones who do. You know what I'm saying? It's just,
I'm telling you, the ones
who really don't know you are the ones who really, really go hard for you.
They'll support
you. Know what
I'm
and it's like that
stuff
for everybody. You know what I'm saying? Now, I do have those who do know me that, you know, really, really support, but it's, I think the people that don't, it's just like,
Yeah, and I think it's difficult because some people, because I used to take it personal, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's almost like being a child and no one comes to your games, but I think they know you as one person.
I almost ran around the room.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So they haven't met who you're trying to be. But the people that come into your life that don't know you, they already look at you, oh yeah, you got potential, you can do this. They just know you as Daniel, Jonathan, Tammy. And they just know you as you being you, you know what I mean?
Why are you trying to become anything more than what he is? You know what I'm saying? And it's sad to kind of be like that, really.
It really is.
It really is sad because people can evolve. They don't have to be what they are for the rest of their life.
For the rest of their life.
You know?
Yeah. But you kind of see that in our community. People don't think we can evolve. Or you should.
Or they don't want you to.
They don't.
That's the, that to me, I think that's the thing. People don't want to see you.
Sad.
You know, you have some, and I'm not saying that about everybody. So please don't take it personal, but there's some people who don't want to see you grow.
Yeah.
And as sure. you're trying to grow, as you're trying to get to the next level, it's always judgment.
It is.
It's
it is.
Sad, but it is. It's always judgment. Yeah. People want to bring up your past.
Yes.
They want to bring up everything under the sun, stuff that doesn't matter. So it's good that you have a good support system.
Yeah, I thank God. I thank God for that. I really do. But like I said, I mean, it is what it is. Yeah. But I think it's wrong that people do that. Because I know, I mean, right now it's like I know of people who have actually grown in life and become more than what they were, whatever the case might be. But people just cannot accept who they are because they hold them back to what they was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And to me, I'm going to meet you where you are. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you're a doctor now, I'm going to call you doctor, such and such. I'm not going to refer to you as, you know what I'm saying, whatever you were before that title was given to you.
Yeah.
I'm going to respect the level that you are.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to try to bring you back to where you once was. That's just how I am.
Yeah.
And that's the way it should be. That's what it should be.
But certain people just, they can't make that transition. They can't make that change for some odd reason. Don't know why.
Now, do you think it's out of their insecurities?
Yes. Yes. Because not everybody, like I said, want to see you win.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Right.
They don't want to see you win.
Because I think some people can do good as long as you at the level beneath them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
You know what I mean? And I think somebody had told me something like, people hate on you because they can see what you can be sometimes before you can see what you can be. So they hate on your potential. You don't even know why or what's the problem.
Yeah.
Because they know what you're about to do 5 years from now.
Yeah. Yeah. And they don't want you to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think Lynchburg has like a lot of that though.
Yeah.
Because I think it's a great place, but I think also too, it can be like a box for people if you sit there and let it be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And people sometimes they want you to be in that box because that's why I had to actually take the shows out of Lynchburg because I saw myself just running around in the same old circle.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Like doing the same old thing, seeing the same old people, having the same success. And I was like, if I ever want to grow, I have to get out of Lynchburg and
grow.
Yeah, you
got to branch out.
You know what I'm saying? And branch out. So, and it was a hard transition, but you know, it is what it is.
And so for you yourself, you said earlier, I know we were talking before, you're not in any of the plays. How do you feel about, are you more of a behind the scenes person or do you like to be like, do you want everybody to know, hey, I'm the person who wrote this play. I'm the person who put this together.
Not humble.
No, it's not. Hey, no,
Lord.
It's not. I'm not trying to say.
Ooh, that sound like, yeah.
Not in that manner, but.
I'm the one who did it all. Me. I want to get the glory and the praise. No, I'm joking. That's what it sounded like. I'm not going to say that, though.
Good morning.
I'm not going to say that.
Okay. But, you know, sometimes people, and it's not necessarily a bad thing if you want it to be known.
Yeah.
I'm the kind of person who, in the past, I've always kind of shied away from things. Jonathan, we were talking about that. Uh-huh. I've not been the person. I'm not a person who wants to be on Front Street.
Right.
I don't want people to know a lot of times who I am, but I think I've cut myself short, and I've also not allowed people to see God move in my life because I've been so shy with saying,
so private.
Oh, I have this, or oh, I got a business, you know, because at the end of the day, I feel like that doesn't really make me.
Right.
But in the same token, it's like, I'm not giving God credit for what he's done by trying to stay behind the scenes.
Yeah.
So some people will take it as not sounding humble, and some people will take it as you're bragging because you say, I'm the person who wrote this play, I'm the person who put it together. But that's not your problem, that's theirs.
Yeah.
You know where you stand. You know if you're humble or not.
Yeah.
You know who you are. So I guess that's why I asked the question, because for me, you know, I've been and wrote a whole play, and then the people come out and want to know who Tammy is, and Tammy somewhere don't want to be seen. So I just want to know, is Daniel out there? Hey, I'm Daniel, you know, signing the people's program from the play, or are you just low-key?
I'm in between.
Okay.
And I'm being honest. And the reason why I say this is because I'm in between, because I don't like to be in the shows at all because of the fact I used to do that when I couldn't find nobody. So I had to. You know, at first it was 5 people, including myself. So I had to be in the show. But when God sent me a lot more people, I was like, well, Lord, this is my cue to kind of step back into the background.
Okay.
And I love being on the side of just directing and just doing the business work and not really having to kind of remember lines and then also, you know, worry about all the other business things too. But I do also like that people can put a face behind who did it. Yeah. So at the end, I do like coming out and talking and telling people why I did what I did.
Okay.
And I don't, I mean, if I could give that to somebody else, but I feel like, you know, if God didn't give them that vision, you know, they may not be able to tell it like I can tell it.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So, and not to say I never do it because, you know, if there's a time where I just can't do a show or whatever because of sickness or whatever, I would trust somebody to do that for me. Okay. But if I'm able to do it, I'm going to do it. Okay. So I say in the middle, I kind of like, because I want people to know. And I think everybody, when you have a dream and you're actually doing great things, they should know who to applaud. You know, if you're selling great T-shirts, I should know who to go to, you know, to say, hey, that was a great T-shirt. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Not just, well, who did that? Well, it's Sally in the corner, but Sally didn't want to show her face. tell Sally to come on over so I can tell her, you know, she did a great job
with the T-shirt.
Come on now, yeah. Sally. You know what I'm saying? So I think it should be in a little bit in the middle, but not too much of it.
Okay.
But do you feel that it's easier to be behind the scenes?
Way easier.
Yeah, because with me, being in front of the camera wasn't how I really planned it. Mm-hmm. And I find it easy to produce other content.
Oh, so, then to be in it?
Yeah, so if Tim had an idea, I'd get behind that all day.
Right.
When I got to do it, it's almost like, it's not a task. It's just knowing, okay, now I got to carry this idea to fruition.
Okay.
Where I can push her. So if I don't feel like doing it, who's pushing me?
Right,
Do you ever feel like that? Like, it's just you. Like, you really got to push it.
No, because I have a great group of people in the shows. Mm-hmm. You know, cast and crew and band and sound.
Gotcha.
So I have a great set of people, honest to God. So you said, like, push the idea?
Yeah, like, push it before it gets to, like, the whole creation phase. So, like, when you're in the thought phase, the new idea.
Yeah, no, I have a good group of people, you know, that push me, even when I feel like they're always there, like, well, come on, we got to do it. So I thank God for that.
Do they ever say, no, I don't think this is a good idea?
Honest to God. You know what I'm saying? And it's crazy. I let them have a lot of say in what they do.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, when they get the script, and if they don't like something, they'll tell me. But, like, none of them have said, like, oh, this ain't it. Like, they'll fix it, be like, well, let's try this instead. But they never blatantly said, are you talking about, like, a play? Like, this is a bad, play? Mm-hmm. Yeah, no one has ever said that about a play. And they may have thought it. They may have said it in their homes. Okay. But no one came to me and said, and they ain't got back to me. So, I mean, they might be trashing it. They might be trashing the house like, man, this is
garbage.
This is garbage. But I got to show it to rehearse tomorrow and smile like I like doing this. So... Yeah. But it ain't never get back to me.
But are you that married to the idea where you take offense, or do you just take it and kind of run with it?
Oh no, I whatever they got to say, whether it's good or bad, you know, I'll take it. And honestly, I would, if you were to come and read a script, be like, I think it should be X, Y, and Z, I would take it into consideration and I'd do it if it makes sense. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I never want to be like, well, this is my play. You can't make any changes.
Some people aren't open to that constructive criticism.
Open. Very open, yeah. The cast and band, they have really, honestly, a lot of creative control with all of my shows. That's no lie. Like, they edit and fix and change all the time. And I'm okay with it.
Okay.
Because you got to play the part, not me.
Yeah.
You know?
So how was that relationship? Like, what is your process? Like, when you're sitting down, and how do you start writing? How you develop characters?
The play we're doing now, Sunday morning, it took me, I want to say, probably like 3 or 4 months to write.
Mm-hmm.
But usually it comes to me in like random moments. Like the show before, well, a couple of shows before that, we did Dear God, Thanks to My Child. And like the plot came to me, or the storyline came to me when I was in a Bible study. And it was crazy because I was thinking about it. And like I couldn't pay attention to what he was saying because the Lord was just giving me it. Like, this is what you need to talk about and all that stuff like that. So I went back home, and I didn't write the whole play that night, but I wrote a good portion, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it just kind of comes in random moments. I we could be here talking, and I'd be thinking about something and be like, that might be a good idea, but, you know.
Gotcha.
So are you, like, brainstorming, writing different ideas down, or are you literally sitting down and just writing it out when it comes to you?
Usually, if I have, like, an idea, I, like, store it in the back of my mind. If I can remember it. If it's something I may not remember, I got to write down in my phone.
Uh-huh.
But majority of the time, I can just remember an idea and just go off that.
Yeah. Okay.
But as a storyline, the Lord gives me that as I'm writing a show. So, like, all the plots and twists and turns, like, that kind of comes as I'm, like, writing it.
Mm-hmm. And tell me, what's the name of this play?
Sunday Morning.
That's the name of the play?
That's the name of the play, Sunday Morning.
Early
That's
in the morning.
Okay.
Sunday Morning. And to God be the glory, it's been doing really good so far. So, in Lynchburg. Yeah, so... And it talks about church stuff.
Okay. So when you write them, do you have, like, you know, as you're developing them, like, a message you want to get out, or does it just come?
It's a message that I want to get out. Like, all of them has messages, you know what I'm saying? Okay. So it's like this one is about change. So the whole show is revolving around like how people, sometimes people don't feel like they want to change. I mean, it's how sometimes people, not everybody likes change, but change is necessary. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's basically what the show is about. Sunday morning, you know. But it has a whole lot of characters and dealing with change and stuff like that and how they kind of, you know, some are with it, some are not. So, yeah. It's a very interesting show. Can't give too much away because I don't know when it's going to air. I don't want to mess with no ticket sales.
So how many characters have you been? How many characters have been inspired by your life or personal?
How many characters? Like in my shows?
Yeah, like have you ever taken like a personal experience and then took that out and then developed a character?
No, I have not.
You haven't?
I have not. I've not done that yet.
They're not really personal life.
Oh, no, no. I mean, like, you know, the issues are, but like the people in it, no, I won't write a character based off this person. No,
but none off of your personal, yourself. Okay.
Mm-mm, no, I ain't like that. Yeah. And that is like a Tyler Perry, how they, you know, how he does stuff like that, but no.
Yeah, because I hear certain directors, they'll talk about, like, their creative process.
Yeah.
Sometimes they'll take something they went through and make a character. Mm-mm. So it may not be as, like, loosely, but they're taking, like, emotions or, you know, a certain scenario, you know.
No, I haven't done that yet. Not to say that I won't do it, but I haven't done it yet up to this point. So,
yeah. Gotcha.
I never say never. So, yeah. But it's been pretty interesting so far with all the characters in it. And, I mean, the people that God has given me, the characters that are in my head, they match the people. Like, they're able to really bring them to life. So, it's nice. It's nice.
Sounds good.
Yes.
So, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, where do you want to see this go?
I pray that we can really do well in other cities. That's my biggest thing. Because we do well in Lynchburg, thank God. But now we're trying to grow to other cities. So 5 or 10 years from now, I pray that we're able to expand the vision more and being able to really, you know, just go to theaters and just really sell them out and do a really great job. You know what I'm saying? And just you know, I guess just bring the message to more people in other cities and just, you know, just continue to do God's work, you know. And
so what's the holdup? I mean, would you like reenact some of the plays you've done previously in other cities?
I definitely will. I, you know, when that time comes and I can see the growth, I will definitely go back and do other stuff on a bigger scale. Because the plays that we did back then, they weren't on a bigger scale. It was just more so like, you know, like I said, church plays. Mm-hmm. Not saying that they weren't big. They were at the time. Mm-hmm. But it's always room for improvement.
But you evolve.
Yeah. I would definitely go back and, you know, because I think some of the ideas that I had back in the past, I mean, the messages were really great. Mm-hmm. And they were scriptural. It was great. So I would definitely go back and utilize some more stuff. So, yeah, keeps me having to work so hard and think of, like, what's next?
kind of repurpose, reinvent.
Yeah. So, yeah.
I mean, because, like, don't they, like, you have one play, like, of course, The Color Purple. How many times have they redone that in New York?
Exactly. Oh, yeah. You know
over
what I'm saying?
Over and over.
Like, and every time they do it, it's interesting. It's, even though you know what's going to happen, but you still there like, wow, this is good. You know what I'm saying?
Actors, yeah.
Exactly.
Settings.
Exactly. Okay. So, yeah, I'm... 5 or 10 years down the line, that's where I pray that I be. You know, just God just has his hand still on this, and we're still doing good, and we're still, you know, progressing and ministering to people. Okay. Especially those who don't go to church. That's the biggest thing. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest thing. Because they need to be talked to, too.
Yeah. And, I think talking about what we talked about earlier, like what Tammy was saying, it's real life stuff.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And to me, I can't get down with corny Christian movies.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Where it's like, I'm not throwing anybody under the bus or anything, but...
Who corny? Let's
you know what I'm saying?
That's
you know,
one of the rules. Real? That's one of the rules. We're not going to call no names. We're not going to talk about nobody.
Like, because it's corny, like real
put
movies.
An ad to that. You know I'm just
like outside of Christian, it's corny street movies.
It is.
Corny love movies. So to me, I think you got to paint the whole picture.
Yes.
So that's why, true. Like, you know, I trip when people use a real depiction of life. You got somebody cursing somebody. That's how life is.
That is.
So
that
you
is.
Can't shelter them from what you're trying to deliver them from.
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? You got to show it to them.
Yeah, yeah. And that's what I'm big on. You know what I'm saying? I don't want people to walk in and be like, that was just corny. You know what I'm saying? No. I want you to walk in and be like, that was really good, you know? Yeah. And that's how my life looked 30 minutes before I walked out the house.
That's it.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, and I just think that people don't really want to do that now. There was a movie that I watched in the movie theater that was kind of like, that was like a little corny Christian movie. I was just saying to myself, we could do better.
Yeah, because I've seen some good ones. You know what I mean? I've seen good ones. Then there's some I've seen where it's like your typical message.
You know what I mean?
And I think that's where some people get criticized because it's not really the same message, but you're putting out certain stereotypes.
Right, you know what I mean? Right, right.
So to me, for me to like I said, a crime show or whatever, it's got to be real. You know, like Law and Order is real.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Versus, you know, when people try to do too much. You know, you over-exaggerate a character here and then it's not real. But I think with Christian movies, they have the best, you know, topics. Because you got everything.
That's true.
But I think some of them probably go in it and they're not, and they're letting people pervert their creative process.
Yeah.
Because they're thinking about, well, I can't write this this way because somebody's going to think this. And now you've put out something that God didn't really give you to put out.
Right.
Because you let somebody, like, he gave you this vision, and now by the time it comes out, it's what they wanted, not what he wanted them to see.
Right, you know what I mean?
Because you're watering everything down, and he wanted you to give them the real. Maybe it's somebody that's dealing with suicidal thoughts
or dealing with
abortion, you know what I'm saying, or whatever the case may be, but you did, but you took that out your script.
That's good. And I think a lot of people actually do that, you know what I'm saying? Just be real with it, you know? And like I said, those who accept it, accept, and those who don't, they just don't, you know? Right. Everything is not for everybody. But don't hold up somebody else's blessing because, like you said, you're trying to water down topics that needs to be talked about, you know? So
people shy away from them so often, though.
Yeah, they do.
And now with everything, you know, in the world, you have to almost be careful about what you say sometimes because you might say one bad thing in the play and then nobody want to come see your play.
You know, and I don't know why. And honestly, God, I don't really like that. You know,
I don't like it either.
The cancel culture is so
real.
But it's real.
My thing is like, you know, it's you can't say nothing.
Everybody's sensitive. You can't say anything.
You can't say nothing. I'm looking like y'all really care too much about these people's feelings, you know?
And this is the point where comedians, they're afraid to go on stage. Like Martin Lawrence and these guys, they said that's why they don't do tours.
Yeah.
Because they know if they say one thing, their career is gone.
That's so sad. And that's really, it's like I don't know. I ain't trying to cancel me. Let me not say no more. Turn the cameras off so we can really talk.
and I think it's a form of, like, because when you're in media, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't realize that until it was like 6 months ago. Somebody's like, yo, well, you know, you're no different than WSET, you're media. He was like, you got to be careful. Because then what we say now and it's posted, you don't have enough delete buttons to take that down.
That's right. That's right.
Because once someone shares,
and people always,
and they share it,
they try to put their own words into what it is that you're saying.
Clickbait.
And they'll edit that thing, though. They'll cut it down.
Yes.
Where if you don't have the full, you know, because I've seen a couple of YouTube videos where guys were doing that. They were like, watch this clip. What do you think he was talking about? Then they would show you 30 seconds prior. It's a whole different conversation.
They do it with Mike Todd a lot, the pastor.
Yeah.
They do it with him a lot, you know. And because, I mean, you know, and I'm not going to lie. There were things I used to watch of him, and I used to be like, oh, well, why did he say this? But then some would tell me, be like, you need to watch the entire thing. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Don't just watch with someone a clip and post it and then want everybody to react on one thing without watching the entire thing. And I think that's not fair to people who do that, you know?
Yeah.
It's not.
Because it's not fair
because it's like, it's almost like people want you to be someone else. You can't be real. You can't be who you are.
You can't.
You can't have an opinion about certain things anymore. Your opinion is just the worst thing.
Yeah.
Nobody can agree to disagree.
No more.
It's always a whole fallout.
Yeah.
And it's a mess. But it shouldn't be like that. But reality is that that's what it is.
My biggest thing is I respect everybody. And my thing is I pray that you respect me. Like, we can disagree on a topic, but I'm not going to sit there and, you know, call you out of your name and just not talk to you or whatever. Like, I'm just going to respect how you feel and pray that you respect how I feel. That's how it should be. But people ain't like that. Once you disagree with them, it's kind of like, well, that's it. You know?
Yeah.
You gone too.
Yeah.
And it's like, dang.
Yeah. And a lot of it's clickbait too.
Yeah.
Because I was like my son going to Virginia Tech. And I remember talking to him and I think he had just committed, right? So we were looking at these, like thousands of comments. And some of them were like trashing him, his size, his weight, and blah, blah. I'm like, you know, you're property of the public. It's just like me. Like, if somebody share this and they talk about the way I look or whatever, I'm property of the public. This is what I signed up for.
Right, right.
So, do y'all know who Gary Vaynerchuk is? Gary V?
I don't.
So, he owns VaynerX. You got to check him out. So, he owns VaynerX, and there's a company that does, like, social media marketing. He's huge on social media. So, he said you got to fall out of love with the good and the bad. So, this is a great interview. Somebody say, hey, good job. Say thank you and keep moving. That way you don't really get thrown off when they don't like it.
Wow.
Because you just fall in love with the process of recording, so you don't care what they talk about.
Yeah.
Because I look at, like, LeBron James and these guys. You got people that are making money off of just talking about people.
Mm. Yeah.
We're going to do a podcast on how bad this dude played.
Right.
Or what this person doing or who they married.
Mm-hmm.
It's people that's really making, like, you know, economy off of just gossip.
Yeah.
And I mean, and it's okay, I guess, if you want to talk about it. But my thing is, don't pick and choose what we can and can't talk about.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the problem comes from me. Yeah. If we're going to talk, let's talk about everything.
Let's talk.
Yeah. Everybody's entitled to feel how they feel about things.
Yes.
But I think you got to be careful, too.
You do.
Because you got people like Vlad TV and, you know, people that say, you know, he a young rapper, right?
Mm-hmm.
So me and you know him, Tim.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to ask him a question. A question that he should never answer.
Mm-hmm.
So now he answered, he get gassed up, his boys with him, and now he did 2 weeks later because he answered a question he had no business over this. You see what I'm saying? So I think a lot of people, you got to be very careful, you know what I'm saying? And I think due to social media and how young people, everyone want that 15 minutes of fame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
TikTok, you got the 30 seconds of fame.
Yeah.
People are really like, they're not thinking, you know what I'm saying? And I think they're saying stuff, not realizing that it's consequences. Because not everybody is just going to be giggles and laughs in front of the camera.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And that's what's sad about these young boys, like these young rappers, every other day.
Yeah.
It's sad. It is sad.
But if you go back and watch it, it's like culture.
You know, we
clap. But if the rapper doing good, 2 likes.
Yeah.
3 likes. Rapper start a business, 10 likes.
Mm-hmm.
Rapper get killed, 350 million views.
And you got people, you know, support them. They ain't never supported, you know what I'm saying? Which is kind of like, it's crazy. It really is crazy how people just move sometimes.
It is.
You know, but we had this conversation going to Greensboro, and me and my aunt, and like how people like spare feelings or whatever the case might be. And my aunt was telling me that her granddaughter, which is my cousin, they was giving out trophies. They kids, you know, giving out trophies to everybody. But it was supposed to be like, you know, hey, the best person get this. But they ended up giving trophies to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I told her, I said, when I have a kid, you know, I'm not going to sit there and expect my child to get a trophy if they was trash.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
my thing is that why are we rewarding trash? I don't care if your kid or not. If your kid is trash, your kid is trash.
Trash.
You know what I'm saying? But the thing is that you're in, no, for real, you know, you're sitting
you're
telling these kids
that it's okay to be mediocre,
whatever the case might be. But then two, it's like if things don't go their way in life, they, you know, catch a fit or whatever because it's not going their way.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think you should be like that for anybody. There is such thing as the best and the worst.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if you are the best, you should be applauded.
That's
but if you are the worst, no, you should not get a trophy because that person worked their behind off to get to where
they are.
And they should be recognized for what they did, kid or no kid. If you're an adult or whatever the case might be, that's fine. But I still think that you should not be applauded if you are not the best. And
you
I was like, what are you giving all these kids trophies for?
Obviously.
And if I'm not saying my cousin won't the best. But if she, I mean, you know what I'm saying? If she was the worst, why are you getting the trophy? I'd be the one to tell you, get that trophy back. You weren't good. I was there. You know? But it's another thing that goes into that, too. You know what I'm saying?
It does. It
is. Just, I mean, it's a bad generation,
I'm telling you.
To me, what do you work hard for?
What do you work hard
for? If I'm going to be first in line and the reward is the same for the person last
in line. Just last in line.
Yes.
Now you're devaluing the reward, the process,
that's
the whole system.
That's
what will happen next is it won't be no rewards. Nobody will get a trophy.
Everybody
get
the same thing.
Well, it's like they'll get
everybody
it, but
the
it's no...
Thing.
The person that's getting it first realize, oh, okay, I don't even want this.
I'm not going to work hard for it because everybody else going to get it. You know what I'm saying? So what's the point? And it's like, it shouldn't be like that, you know?
Yeah, because that's like when you do your plays or whatever, I think you're striving for something. You see what I'm saying? So the hours, you said, what, 65 pages?
Mm-hmm. 65
years. Versus somebody to do a mediocre 10.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know?
It's two different levels, right?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know. What do you think, Tammy?
I don't know.
I was spending some real stuff. I'm sorry.
I had to bring it back.
No, it's the truth though.
I think
that everybody wants to be rewarded.
Yeah.
And it's killing the kids, though.
It is. Well, kids these days, they feel like they have a sense of entitlement anyway.
Because the parents.
Yeah.
The parents.
And I think stuff like that plays a part in it.
It does.
Yeah.
It does. Because the parents, I remember coaching, and you want your kid to run the ball every play.
Yeah.
You want your kid to do this. And, like, you know, he might not be meant for that.
Yeah.
Because you didn't do it in your childhood. You want to live vicariously through your son.
Through your kid.
Yes.
And then you're going to choke the love of whatever that is out of them, and then this cycle starts, this vicious cycle.
Yeah. It's just, you know, like I said, it's just, I think we as a people really need to kind of get back to, I guess, kind of like how it was before my time. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because I think now things have happened and people are just more cautious. But I feel like, you know, there's time and place for everything. You know, yes, people should be rewarded. Everybody, when, you know, certain situations call for it.
Yeah.
But in most situations, you know, you have, you know, of course, like I said, the best and the worst. So I don't feel like the worst and the best should be on the same. It shouldn't be, you know.
Yeah, because I think it's different levels of sacrifice.
It is. It is. And people out here working really hard for their craft and what they do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's sad that, you know, they get the same thing that somebody else who didn't put that much time, like you said, you know, it's not right. It's not right.
So tell me this, going back, I know you were talking about your plays. And what about reaching the person who was not saved, who's not a Christian? How are your plays, how are you going to be able to entice that person? Because if I'm already not a believer, and then I see a play, I don't know, The Child of God. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not going to want to go see that because I don't believe.
Right.
So how are you going to get to me?
So I try not to make my plays like titles like that.
Okay.
So like Still Wear Your Name, that was an R&B song. So I try to do it like that. So when you see the plays, like, I really want them to be like names that it's not like, you know,
really can't tell what it's about.
Right. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, Seven Day Church or whatever the case might be. Like, it's nothing like that. The only reason why Sunday Morning came about is because I really want to talk about topics that were happening in church. But everything before that was more so like.
So we can't get no examples and then because the play ain't came out yet.
Oh, I can give you examples.
Okay, so give me some stuff happened on Sunday morning.
Okay.
Because this, you know, early morning talk, so let's talk about what happened on Sunday morning.
Basically, so switching gears to Sunday morning. So it's about a pastor in a church who has news to tell his congregation. But before he can tell them the news, there's a lot of things going on in the church, like, you know, family turmoil, relationship issues, and, like, secrets. Like, a lot of things happen in the church, so it kind of prevents him from telling the news that he needs to share. So basically, you have to, you know, watch the entire show to see, is he able to tell the news or is he, you know, just can't because of so much stuff happening in the church. And he's trying to navigate all of this stuff. So it's a lot of storylines in this show. You got to kind of, like, be there from the beginning to end to kind of know where everybody stands in the church. So, yeah. And this is the only play that I've done that's been more religious than anything. But the drama is good, you know? We just can't really turn up like that because it's in a church. It's you know what I'm saying? But, I mean, God gave me this idea. But every other thing before that was more so, you know, not so we got to keep it like this. Okay. So, yeah. That's where that was.
So you still didn't really give me any details.
Oh, God.
But okay.
That's what I can give
you. And I can't make it Saturday to the play. Oh, Lord. What day is the play?
It's the 24th. It's Destiny Christian Fellowship.
And what day is that? Saturday.
It's Saturday. Yeah, it's Saturday. It's this Saturday coming up. I got to give you a DVD.
Okay. All right.
That's all, you know.
So doing your plays, right? I'm sure you like analyze church. You watch people. To get your ideas, do you feel like people are more connected to the thought of church as a building versus having a relationship with God nowadays, 2023?
That's a good question. That is a good question. That literally had me stumped. I'm looking like, I knew you was going with it. I said, oh, God.
Yeah, because think about it. I mean, you got people with gym memberships.
Yeah.
They don't mean they connected to the thought of living healthy.
Yeah, I don't think everybody who goes to church is. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You said it's connected to...
Yeah, like they like the building, the church,
right.
versus having a relationship with God.
Yeah, I think you can be in church and not really have a great relationship with Him. I think.
Well, no relationship.
Mm-hmm. Or no relationship at all. You're just there. Because you might be there just because, you know, you could be my mom and you bring me to church and I'm just there because you want me to come.
But you could be there because you think the pastor look good.
Oh, that too. You know what I'm saying? And you sit on the front row, want his attention. Saints.
That part.
You know what I'm saying? But, I mean, people go to church for different reasons, you know? So
Yeah. Because I think now the people, and not only in church, but if you look at social media, people fall in love with looking like they got the thing versus having the thing.
Right.
So we'll take a picture here, boom.
Yeah.
I was on the radio or whatever. Now, this is something that we got to build, so we can't be content with just looking like we got the thing.
Right.
But I think a lot of people are, they want you to think they spiritual. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Jesus used parables. Like, he don't big words and all that. He was using parables, stories. And so that's why I think, like, a lot of people get turned away.
Right.
Because they come chasing God, but they come through a building, not realizing that that's not really the way. This is where you assemble and worship him.
And fellowship. Yeah.
But you got to come to him through his spirit. You know what I mean? So, and I think depending on how it's taught.
Yeah.
Because I think one of y'all said it early. Like, it's just these, like, your mindset or whatever you adopted.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's all people know.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think it was like that for me when I went to, because I made a transition to another church because there was a lot of things that was happening in my church at one point in time. And I had to make that switch because I had to make sure that I wasn't going to church. Because, I mean, there was a time when I was going because I was in charge of the praise dance team. I was singing on the choir. I was doing usher. Like, I was just doing all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like I was going to church because I had a job to do, you know, like, and I wasn't going for the encounter.
Wow.
So I had to, and there was something that happened in the church that literally made me kind of step back and be like, well, wait a minute, all these years, I was going just for responsibilities. And I had a lot of things that I was trying to do at the church and trying to be faithful and was missing, you know what I'm saying, the encounter with the Lord there. I wasn't getting that. And I don't know why. I was singing the choir and everything, but just wasn't getting it. So when that situation happened, I was able to step away and go to another church that I had no responsibility in.
Mm-hmm.
And I was there just for the word.
So then you kind of asked the question, was it employment or assignment? You see what I'm saying?
It was an assignment. I'm going to get paid.
Because I've been in the same boat where you're so busy.
Yeah.
And it felt like employment.
I'm telling you.
It felt like you're punching the clock. And what was the message about?
I don't know. And that's what it was.
But
and
I think a true assignment from God, like, you operate in that ministry.
Yes.
But I think a lot of people do that.
Yeah.
A lot of people do that.
But it took that incident, that situation that happened in the church, it took that for me to actually step back and kind of analyze and be like, well, I've been doing this for a long time, and I've been leaving the same way that I've come into church.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? People are talking about, well, I got a word to carry me from, you know, this Sunday to the next. I'm looking like, what word?
Where was the word at?
Where was the word at? You know what I'm saying? But it took that incident for me to kind of step back and really focus in on church and, you know, get my relationship back right with God how it should be.
Okay.
If I'm being honest.
So do you think it's like getting a good word? Because I've had this conversation with my mom. Getting a good word when you leave from church, letting it download in your spirit, you showing the proof of you actually trying to live the word. Like, what is
right?
Like, what do you think one takes away from that? Just say, okay, I'm getting a good word.
That's a good question. Yeah. How you feel on that?
Yeah,
I'm passing on to you.
Because
I'm like, because that.
Some people are so used to just hearing a good word, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you got a nice pastor that's good with words, it's almost like going to a rap battle, like poetry. You're like, oh, that's dope. But then you leave, and it ain't really in here. And you're not really acting it out, but you falling in love with just the style, the wordsmithing. You know what I'm saying? You know, like when people will say, like, they'll read a sentence, and they're like, woo. And are you really receiving it, or is it just wowing you?
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying.
Well, I've had some pastors like that too that can, you know, be real good with words and stuff like that. But you know,
because there's been times I've heard like some like sermons, man, that get in here, like for real. Like I know, like I ain't talked to nobody about this,
right?
Yeah,
right.
But then I see people that are so like, you know, there's like their program with cliches.
Yeah,
they ain't read the scripture at all. They just know how to quote that back end of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So what do y'all think though? Because I think culturally, sometimes we fall in love with these habits.
I think for me, when I go to church on Sunday, yes, it's. I feel like I want to get a good word. I need to go to church on Sunday. It carries me through, like you said, to the next Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
I have to be open to hear what's being said, because a lot of times if I don't go in with the open mind that I'm going to receive something, then I'm not going to get it.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, you know, when you get up in the morning, it's like, it's Sunday, I got to go to church.
Yeah.
So you do think, I got to go to church because I'm supposed to go to church, so I got to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But again, when I en route, because I got a little ride to Lynchburg, you know, so I have to get my mind right to be able to receive what's being given.
Right.
Sometimes that's different, depending on who, you know, was given the word that Sunday morning.
Yeah, yeah.
And it does sometimes make it harder to receive from one, you know, or another. Right. But I feel like for me, I go and I do try to carry mine out.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, nobody's perfect. Yeah, and I've never proclaimed to be perfect. But at the end of the day, I have my own personal relationship with God.
Right.
I know where I stand with him. I've had my own encounters with God.
Mm.
There's nothing that a person can say to me to make me think that he's non-existent.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I can't relate to the people who go to church and who just don't get, or they're going just because, or you know. But I think it's different for everybody, and I guess it's different seasons for people too, because it took me a while to get to, you know, from one phase to the next phase to the next. So I think that I don't know if I answered your question right or not.
I think you did, because I think everyone's personal, but I think some people
I think they do go just say they went. And
yeah, it's kind of like an act of either obligation, practice.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Because think about how you first felt like, okay, I'm going to school. I got to get up. I got to go to school.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow I got to go to school. I take the weekend off, then I go to school.
Mm-hmm.
Are you really getting anything from it?
Right.
And then are you going to take what you're getting and apply? And that's what I think is, like, I got eczema, right? Mm-hmm. So no matter how bad the breakup, unless I apply the cream.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I think some people have the responsibility too, like, you got to start applying this stuff at some point. People going, like, I think we hit some gems on this hour.
Yeah.
Where it's up to people. Like, you can hear it all day, but if you don't, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like, and you have to be willing to, you have to be open to it.
Yeah. A lot of people aren't. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people aren't.